Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Montezuma Church of the Brethren. God bless you. God bless you. Right on left field. Good to see you. We have a big day today. We're looking forward to dedicating a baby. We haven't done that in a while, so here we are. We're going to do that outside today. I just want to run through a few details with you, remind you that we are making apple butter down here at the hall on the 10th of October. That's a Saturday, and there'll be some days leading up that we'll need some workers for that. Then on the 17th, we're making barbecue chicken. We're selling apple butter. I think we'll have some ham sandwiches. We're looking forward to those two Saturdays, just a reduced kind of heritage festival, but we are going to sell some of the major items. Just remind you about our Bible studies, Wednesday morning book group, Thursday night Bible study on Zoom. Our outreach offering for this month, September, is Open Doors. And, we are not going to be able to host Open Doors this year in our meeting house as we have in previous years, but they're still going to need our support financially and also some of our volunteers. So that will be something we'll talk about as the fall develops. Sunday School for Children, we've been sending out emails and videos for our children to have activities during the week whenever it suits them. And if you are not getting those things and you have a child, an elementary age or preschool age child, contact me or the church office and we'll see what we can do. Junior and senior high Sunday school today at the Montezuma Hall. I'm going to be your teacher today. Let's try to meet down there under the pavilion. Just give me a minute to get there. I won't be quite as quick getting there, but I'm coming. So I'd like to meet with the youth today, junior and senior high, and look forward to that. Footsteppers are going to meet over here at the pavilion, the Ruerton Pavilion, so we're good for that. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of October, traditionally our love feast, our fall love feast. Of course, we'll not be able to do that, but we are going to have communion here at the ballpark. And it's prepackaged kind of communion elements, so a little piece of kind of bread and a little juice cup, and it will hand it to you as you come in next week. So that's going to be part of the service next week. We're looking forward to that. Pastor Dave is preaching next week, and I think his mom and stepdad are going to be here to provide some music for us, so we're grateful for them. We're grateful for our musicians today, for Susan Estes and our own Ralph Rohr. So we're looking forward to their leadership this morning. I do want to just take a minute to remind you that here's how I'm thinking about the schedule right now. I'd like us to at least meet outdoors for the next five Sundays, all of October, and at least the first Sunday of November. I know that we have no control over the weather, we never do. But that's kind of how I'm looking at it. I'm looking out that far. Pastor Dave's last Sunday is the 1st of November. And I think the best way for us to have as many people here as possible is to be outside. And so we're going to try to aim for the 1st of November, at least that long to meet here at the ballpark. We'll see what we can do. We are planning to have a farewell reception for Gabe and Pam and Elias. That will be later in October, probably down here at the hall, and it will be a reception style. We won't have a program where we're all together one time, but people will just sort of pass through. That's very sad to me, and I know to Gabe and Pam, but given the reality of our circumstances right now, this is just what we'll have to do. And so we will get you the details about that reception early this week. We're making final plans tomorrow night. So we are looking forward to that time with the Dodd family. And they're on vacation this week. So that's why you're not seeing Pastor Gabe here. Gabe is going to have a youth day October 3rd, that's just this coming Saturday now, at Brethren Woods with junior and senior high youth. It's going to be all day. It's going to include some meals, including a supper for the family. So everybody's going to be there with the youth program. So we're looking forward to that this coming Saturday at Brethren Woods. Welcome to worship. Please pray with me. Gracious God, in this hour we gather under the sky to worship you, to remember our baptismal promises, and to renew the ties that bind us together. Lord, let your spirit be in our midst, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, come, angel band,
I've almost gained my heavenly home. My spirit loudly sings. The Holy One, behold, they come. I hear the sounds of wings.
We're going to turn now to our baby dedication. And Brother Bob, you can come and join me here. Dedication of a child with the church does two things that I think of. First, it takes this child seriously by acknowledging that this little, vulnerable, and needy person is a human being created in the image of God, beloved by Jesus, and surrounded and filled with the Holy Spirit. Another thing that it does is that it sets the life of this child in the midst of a community of people, of faith, in their family, where Joseph and Mary will provide the love and care every day of Hudson's life, and that his big sisters, Taylor and Madison, will be a part of his life too. But beyond that nuclear family and the extended family that is present here today, also this faith community. community that will share in the raising of this child, the shaping of him. And so it is in this context of recognizing the incredible worth of Hudson that we also place him in the midst of this community of people who love him and who will care for him and take responsibility for him, to raise him in this faith and to help him follow in the path of Christ. And so it is in this way that we gather today to dedicate him, Hudson Thomas McNeth, born June 25 of this year in Fishersville. And his deacons are Bob and Patty Black. And so Bob is representing the congregation this morning. Patty's not feeling the best, so we look forward to Bob's participation in this service. And I wanted to ask Joseph and Mary three questions. And make three promises. Mary and Joe, you have shared in God's creative power, bringing forth this beautiful new life. Will you pledge to support and love Hudson by providing the opportunity for him to grow up in the family of faith with the hope that he will someday confess Christ as his own teacher, Lord, and Savior? And will you, to the best of your ability and with God's help, provide a loving family environment in which Hudson can grow in love, loyalty, and obedience to God? Will you encourage Hudson to grow in faith so that he might later be received into the fellowship of the church by baptism, fully partaking in the work and worship of the church? Mary and Joe have made promises before you today to love their child, to care for him, and to raise him along with their daughters in this community of faith. Now I'm asking each one of us to respond to them. We're at a great distance from one another today, so it's not quite as close, but I'm going to ask you to support this family as well. When I'm done, you will answer, "We will." Mary and Joe, along with other members of their family, have expressed their trust in God and in you, the body of Christ, gathered here by presenting this child for dedication. Will you pledge your support and loving presence in times of ease and difficulty, in times of sorrow and joy, in times of growth and frustration? Will you pledge to be faithful witnesses for Christ in upholding this family, and especially this little one, Hudson? If so, please answer, "We will." All right. Usually my favorite part of this service is when I get to hold the baby and pray. But today I'm going to just look at Hudson and pray. So let's pray together. Holy God, this little child was given as a gift to all of us, and especially to his family's parents and sisters and grandparents and cousins and uncles and aunts. So many people who love this child and who want to protect him and give support to him. We are so thankful for this loving community that surrounds Hudson, and we ask especially that your Spirit would be with him this day and every day of his life, so that he would know that he is not only loved by his family and by his community of faith, by this church, but that he would know that he is loved by you, and that his life is in your hands. Lord, in your mercy, we ask that you would hear our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to ask Bob to give you this gift on behalf of the congregation. It's a children's Bible and a certificate of remembrance for Hudson's dedication. Thank you, Bob. Thank you all very much. Yeah. I'm going to invite the children to come for a brief children's story. All right, you guys can stay. Yeah, you don't have to go. You're already here. Oh, Trevor. Are you wearing it out yet? Yeah. It looks like it's starting to get pretty heavy. Yeah. It won't be long. You're going to be doing a lift perfectly. Hey, you guys, come on. Don't be bashful. We're walking all over Joe's new grass, but that's all right. It's tough enough to take it now, I think. Come on, buddy. Come on over here. How'd baseball season go? Good. All right. Good to see you. All right, everybody. So, you know something? One of the things that I've been thinking about, especially in relation to you guys, is how you probably remember when we would meet right over there in that meeting house for our worship, right? It wasn't that long ago. Do you remember what it looks like? No? Some of you? Yeah, you know what it looks like. You see the steeple over there and all the rooms. You know, I'm over there all the time, and it is just not the same without you guys. So we do miss our meeting house. We miss being together there because it's a familiar place. It's a great big room. It's one of the biggest rooms around that I know of. And we come in there and we worship every week. And so I miss being in there with you and your families. But you know something? I also kind of like being out here. You know how big that room is over there, that sanctuary? How about out here? Look around. It's pretty big too, isn't it? I just love looking up at the sky and thinking about how out here the world doesn't seem quite so big. I mean, it's big, but the whole world is just kind of part of this big world that we're part of, this big universe. And that all of us are surrounded by God and loved by God, and each and every moment of our day under this big blue sky, on this green earth, we are God's children. And so it's nice to just come out here and worship every Sunday, especially during these nice, pleasant days. We're glad to be outside. So whether we're inside or whether we're outside, this is a beautiful and blessed day. And I hope you just enjoy these outside worship services as much as I do. Because if you ever get bored, what do? You can just kind of look around. Maybe you can collect three-leaf and four-leaf clovers. I mean, there's all sorts of stuff you can do out of here, right? I think it's pretty exciting. Now, as you go back, the congregation is going to sing a song. And this is the song, This Is the Day. It's a kind of a camp song, very familiar. Everybody sings, and you know, we're used to kind of doing an echo style, but today we're all just going to sing every word. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, and be glad in it, This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, that the Lord has made. All right. Thank you all for coming up and being a part of our children's story today. And always remember that outside worship is beautiful worship too. All right. Thank you.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
I heard some singers over here. That's really great. I love it. I love it. Can't be bashful. That's right. We've come to a time of prayer, and I want to just give you a few updates. Sister Janet Wetzel, I think we've all been worried about her. I was just thinking that Janet was joining us for worship. The last time was Easter Sunday of 2019. So it's been a while since we've seen her in our midst, and she's struggled with keeping her health at a high level. She's been in the hospital since last week, last Sunday night, and at Augusta Health, where she's receiving treatment, really to keep her lungs dry, a lot of fluid there. But it's a heart problem for her, so we want to continue to pray for Janet and Joe and for that family. Glenna Rhodes was hospitalized at Augusta Health late Friday evening after suffering a stroke. We anticipate that she will return to Birch Ridge Assisted Living Facility in Fishersville either later today or tomorrow. But let's hold Glenna Rhodes in our prayers and her daughter Pat family. Sarah Cron broke an ankle during volleyball practice earlier this month, and she's on crutches and using orthopedic boots. So let's remember Sarah Cron as well. She's bouncing back pretty fast from that. So we're grateful for good healing there. Joyce Rhodes' son, DJ Motes in Atlanta. He is starting treatment this week for testicular cancer. And that will be both chemotherapy and radiation. I think he's getting a pretty heavy treatment starting this week. So let's remember DJ in our prayers and in cards. We want to continue to pray for students, families, teachers, staff, folks who are in school. It's a trying time for everybody in that respect. So we do want to pray for our school system and for the universities and colleges around us. Also, healthcare workers and hospitals, as we enter this season, traditionally a flu season, but also our continued concern about COVID-19. So let's hold healthcare workers and hospitals in our prayers. First responders, emergency workers, police, firefighters, they respond faithfully and conscientiously to our needs, to our communities. And so we want to support them. We want to pray for elected leaders at every level as they govern during this time of pandemic, of economic challenge, environmental issues related to storms and Western fires, and it's an election season on top of all of that. So we've got a lot going on, and we need to hold one another in prayer and hold those leaders in prayer. And let's just remember always to pray for one another. So join me in prayer now, please. Gracious God, as we pause today under this great dome that is the sky, that is a sign to us of our home under your sight, and we ask that we would not be discouraged, that in the midst of times when we feel frustration or stress or deep worry, that we would also be mindful that we belong to you and that we are part of a community of faith that supports us, lifts us up, and cares for us. We pray that we would care for one another, that our arms would be open, our hearts wide to the needs that are around us. We have called the names of a number of people today that we are mindful of, and we pray for them and ask that your Spirit would be with them for healing and encouragement as they need it. Lord, in your mercy, we pray that you would hear these prayers of ours, and that we would be strengthened in our faith and in our hope. We pray in the words that Jesus taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." I want to invite Sister Tasha Hoover to read our scripture today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The scripture reading today is from the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 18, verses 1 through 4 and 25-32. The word of the Lord came to me. "What do you mean by repeating this proverb concerning the land of Israel? The parents have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As I live, says the Lord God, this proverb shall no more be used by you in Israel. Know that all lives are mine. The life of the parent as well as the life of the child is mine. It is only the person who sins that shall die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is unfair. Hear now, O house of Israel. Is my way unfair? Is it not your ways that are unfair? When the righteous turn away from their righteousness and commit iniquity, they shall die for it. For the iniquity that they have committed shall die. Again, when the wicked turn away from the wickedness they have committed and do what is lawful and right, they shall save their life. Because they considered and turned away from all the transgressions that they had committed, they shall surely live, they shall not die. Yet the house of Israel says, the way of the Lord is unfair. O house of Israel, are my ways unfair? Is it not your ways that are unfair? Therefore, I will judge you, O house of Israel, all of you, according to your ways, says the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions, otherwise iniquity will be ruined. Cast away from you all the transgressions that you have committed against me, and get yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, O house of Israel? For I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, says the Lord God. Turn then and live."
This parable, you know, the parents have eaten sour grapes and the children's teeth have been set on edge, is something I think many of us can relate to, that something that was part of our parents' lives or part of our parents' generation or that was part of the world before we even arrived here, and suddenly, you know, we feel like, it's having a negative impact on us. So it is this parable, the sense that our lives are sort of fated to be controlled by our parents or by our parents' generation's sins, this parable that Ezekiel is rejecting. And I think it is not hard for any of us to imagine ways that we feel like our lives have been affected by our parents or by our parents' generation. I think of James Baldwin. Baldwin was born in 1924. He was born to a woman who was not married, and he never knew his biological father. When he was a toddler, his mother married a man named named David Baldwin. And so David Baldwin became James's father. The family lived in Harlem in the 1920s and 30s, and David Baldwin had trouble finding work. I mean, it was the Great Depression, and that meant that he could hardly keep his family together. He raised his children, and he kept them from starving, but I do not remember in all those years, James wrote about his father, that one of his children was ever glad to see him come home. He was a man beaten down by his circumstances. A poor black man in a world where white people treated him as less than human. David took that out on others. He took it out on people in his neighborhood, and he took it out on his children. James described his father as filled with bitterness, self-hatred, and that he could be incredibly cruel. And so we don't have any trouble, I think, imagining that James Baldwin rejected his father's beliefs and practices with every fiber of his being. And yet, his father was a major theme in his early writings. He clearly had set the teeth of his son on edge. While James would not accept his father's ways and would not imitate him in any way, he did not simply curse or abandon his father and the impact that he had on him. Rather, he struggled to understand him. Baldwin asked, what was it like for his father to live in a world that despised him? To have children that he could not feed, and then to send them out into the streets of Harlem to fend for themselves, to experience the hopeless bitterness, as well as that panic which can scarcely be suppressed when one knows that a person you love is beyond your reach and your protection. Baldwin recalls that the streets of New York were so bad that his parents felt a, quote, peculiar kind of relief, unquote, when some of their children were shipped overseas to fight during World War II. You know, this effort on Baldwin's part, not only to, you know, his effort not to justify his father, but rather to seek to understand him, is what enabled him to do what his father was never able to do. Resist the temptation to allow hatred and bitterness to take over his soul. Baldwin says, in reflecting on his father, one of the reasons people cling to their hates so stubbornly is because they sense once hate is gone, that they will be forced to deal with pain. There is no future in clinging to hatreds. They destroy so much. Hate never failed to destroy the person who hated. Now, this story about James Baldwin is just one story about one family. But it helps me to understand why Ezekiel, and also Jeremiah, who quotes this same parable and rejects it in chapter 31 of Jeremiah, were so insistent that people that they addressed not fall into this sort of easy, familiar trap of thinking that they were simply fated or predetermined to live out of certain circumstances because of what their families were or what their families had done. You know, certainly I think our parents have a huge impact on us. We don't deny that. But that is not the end of the story. You know, the prophet Ezekiel lived during chaotic, disastrous times for the people of Judah. You know, through a series of kings that failed to provide stable leadership, and then because a superpower called Babylon had come to Judah and to Jerusalem and defeated them in battle and invaded the city, and then gathered up the leading citizens of the city and put them in exile 500 miles away from Jerusalem in a place called Babylon. Think of Psalm 137, which says, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down and there we wept as we remembered Zion. How can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? I mean, they are devastated by these events. The prophet Ezekiel is personally devastated. I mean, he had trained to be a priest in the temple in Jerusalem, and that's the only place that you can be a priest in the temple of Jerusalem, is by being in Jerusalem. And here he was, 500 miles away. His life, work, and preparation were taken from him. Everything was just thrown up in the air. It was a total disaster. And who was responsible? The kings? The ruling class? The parents and grandparents? Did their sins set their children's teeth on edge? Yeah, I think we can understand that. Like in Deuteronomy 24, where it says that parents are not responsible for the sins of their children, and children are not responsible for the sins of their parents. Now we don't have to bear those burdens, and it's right that we should not pay for the sins of other people. But neither should we hide behind those sins as if to say, well, you know, that was their problem. You know, that's what they did. We didn't do that. It's not our fault. We just live here. You know, it was on fire when we got here type of thinking. That's what Ezekiel is rejecting. He's taking the path of James Baldwin when he says, you know, don't just reject what your parents or the generation before you did. Take responsibility for the time that you have right now. Be the life that you are supposed to live right now. Take responsibility for that. I think that's what Baldwin did when he wrestled with the impact of his father's bitterness on him. He could have blamed his father and just said, I'm not going to have anything to do with you. I'm just going to walk away from it and not think about it. You know, and that's the kind of shortcut that a lot of us take. We don't want to deal with that pain. We don't want to revisit that hurt. But to achieve something more than just a denial of the experience, or a repetition of it, or a justification of it, or a defense of it, we need to move through it. We need to seek understanding. That self-examination of our lives, so that we will not be subsumed in hatred or resentment. That's what Ezekiel calls repentance. Turn away from your wickedness. Do what is right, and you will save your life. I do not take any pleasure in your death. Turn. That's the Hebrew word. Turn. repent. No, we have, I think, a very pinched idea of what repentance is. We think that it's feeling bad. We think that, oh, I've sinned, I've fallen short of the glory of God, and I just need to do better, and I promise I won't do it again. I think that is part of repentance, but it is not what biblical repentance is. Biblical repentance is about a changed mind, a changed way of seeing the world and thinking. It's turning in a new direction. That's what Ezekiel calls a new heart and a new spirit in verse 31. You know, it is one thing to face a sin that we have committed. It is one thing to turn away from our own wickedness. That's what we're supposed to do. But Ezekiel is challenging the people who are in Babylon, because those are the people he's talking to. He is challenging them to not just see themselves as victims of cruelty. You know, people who are disoriented, that they're so disoriented they can hardly sing a Lord's song in a foreign land. It's like James Baldwin saying, well, I just didn't have a very good father. I had a hard childhood. I hate this. I hate that. He's calling them away from these sort of locked-in patterns of life that they have inherited. They must face the pain of that inheritance, but they are also called to choose life, to accept the freedom of asking themselves, what shall we be? What life shall we try to live now? I think all true prophecy is a call to repentance, the creation of a new heart, a new spirit. That is our call personally, individually. It is also the call of the church and of any society that has enough self-esteem to face its history and not simply feel condemned to defend it or repeat it. Ezekiel is calling Israel to that kind of freedom, to a turning in the spirit. Now, this is not the end of the story for the prophet. In 2 weeks, we'll come back to Ezekiel in chapter 36 and explore the theme of a new heart and a new spirit a little more deeply. But next week, Pastor Gabe will be leading us through Isaiah chapter 5, and we'll have our communion service here. I'm looking forward to that. I hope you will join us for that time together. Let's stand. We'll sing our doxology and have a benediction. Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.